Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Kama ulikuja na mkono nione tafadhali. Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
You look so good. And you look so calm. And I thank God for you. Praise God.
Amen.
I wish all the young people may sit at the front, all of them, so that I may see their lovely faces. But then we also have other challenges, and I cannot be able to see their faces so well because of the masks that people are putting on. And let me just take this chance to tell you that Corona is real. The time had passed when we used to say that the government is lying to us. It is high time we take it seriously, because we are losing young people, we are losing many important people in the society, and for that reason we need not to take it for granted. Even the Bible talks about the hygiene, and that is exactly what we are doing. So if somebody claims to be a Christian and then he does not embrace the hygienic part of the regulations that are given, then even you have a problem. Let me say that I know there are many preachers and many people who say God will protect us, but remember, God also said that we need to take care of ourselves by being clean and being orderly and following the health regulations that are there in the Bible. So may God help us out of this problem.
Amen.
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 Neither can we say that it is a medical problem that only medics can solve. It is a problem that all mighty God can get us out of. It is not the first time. It is not the first time. Many serious and dangerous diseases have been here, and they are all gone because of the power of the mighty God. Say amen for that.
Amen.
Yes. For those who are meeting me for the first time, I'm Evangelist Rogers Nyakado. This is not my first time in this church. Around 3 Sabbaths have passed, I was here, and we had a good time. Let me say, I had a good time knowing some of you. And God saw it wise that I be here again. So I think also the young people who dedicated their time, they were here all the time to make sure that this program be successful. We can also not take it for granted. I am normally a youth minister. I normally do evangelism to the campuses and colleges and many high schools. I love young people. I love speaking to them. And by that, I normally understand a lot of things that happen in their life. And so I thank God for this church, for this program that they have given, that these young people may be nurtured and they may be given guidance in the right direction.
Amen.
Receive greetings from my wife. Rogers is married with 4. My wife called me this morning and she said that I may pass my greetings to you. Is that your own way of receiving a greeting? I was wondering, maybe I should be taught of how you guys receive the greetings. Yeah, I also talked to my pastor this morning, Pastor Timothy Chumo, and he also sent greetings. Let me see how you receive the greetings.
Amen.
This morning, I also got an SMS from Evangelist James Sole, and he also sent greetings. He's also standing on the pulpit today, and all of us are ministering at the same hour, at the same time. Receive also greetings from my fellow evangelist Peter Odhiambo, who is also working together with us with Brother Sode. And I'm glad that we are empowered, that we are working for the Lord during this youthful age.
Amen.
Is there any amen for that?
Amen.
Yes. So, apart from that, I also would want to remember our brother Kimutai, who was here. I believe he has left. And I'm asking this church, together with the leadership, that you may put him in prayers.
Amen.
If you see some young people staggering in the road and they look like they are not sober, they need understanding. You need to understand what they are going through. And as a medical practitioner, you should understand them, that they are under a lot of pressure, especially at this time. So we need to pray for them, that God may keep them at this time, because they are the frontline soldiers that are working here in this country. Let me tell you and confirm to you that the program of the youth was beautiful, it was good, it was so interactive, and those who came, those who attended, were more blessed.
Amen.
And I believe that this church will come up with another program that will empower the young people, not only in this church, but in the whole district.
Amen.
Let us pray. Our Father and our God in heaven, I hang my helpless soul before you at this hour, understanding that I'm a filthy, fecal clay before you, together with all the congregants and your children and your servants. Lord, there is nothing good that comes out of us. If it is not for you, Jesus, we can never do anything. And for that reason, we humble ourselves at this hour, asking in a very special way that even our rough edges and our weaknesses may not be portrayed at this hour. That even your people may listen and hear your voice as we'll be speaking here. Remove pride out of us.
Amen.
Remove arrogance out of us. And replace them with the humility and meekness.
Amen.
That your voice may be heard as a vessel, Lord. Help us to submit unto you. That we may speak words that proceed out of your mouth directly. For it is in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ we pray.
Amen.
Amen. The statistics of this country says that the young people form about 65% of the population of this country. And that is about 9.5 million young people in this country. And I've been looking around, especially during this time of pandemic, and I noticed that many young people are not in churches. Not because they don't like God, but because there is too much pressure on their side as young people. When I walk in the streets, I see a lot of things that are happening in the young people. And I come with one solution. That if God will not come down here to help the young people, we might not have a society of tomorrow. Ikiwa Mungu hatakuja katika upande wetu na kusimama na vijana katika nyakati hizi, hakuna hata mmoja angeweza kusimama. Wapendwa, kama mzazi, ninapoangalia maisha ya vijana jinsi wanavyoenenda, ninapowatazama vile wanavyovaa, mienendo yao, shughuli zao vile wanavyotenda, ninapoangalia kila mahali, naona katika jumuiya na katika familia na ndoa na katika nchi yetu ya Kenya kwamba vijana wameelekea katika njia mbaya. Na kile ambacho wanahitaji sio kuwakemea. Kile ambacho tunahitaji kufanya kama kanisa ni kuweza kurudi chini na kuweza kuelewa katika hali ya kuelewa yale ambayo yanatendeka katika maisha yao. Sincerely, we need to understand the young people. Before we condemn them and crucify them, we need to have an open understanding of what they are going through. Let me tell you that the young people of today are under a lot of pressure, depending on the things that are happening in the world. By saying that, I don't mean that we need to compromise the standards of Christianity in order to understand the young people. But what I'm saying is, before we are quick to judge them and condemn them, we need to understand them. Praise God.
Amen.
And as a youth minister, there used to be a time when I used to condemn many young people. I used to hurl a lot of heavy words against them. I used to disassociate myself with them because I had a notion that they are evil and they are continually pursuing their evil deeds. But even at that, God reminded me one thing, that no one is perfect. That when Jesus was assailed with the case of a young person who was caught in adultery in the name of Mary Magdalene, Jesus uttered these words and said that let him that has no fault be the first to hurl the stones. So in the society and in the church, we need a lot of understanding of everyone. Because you as an elder, do you think you are over sin? You as that mother, do you think you are over sin? You as a minister like me, do you think you have overcome? And then we need to reason. That is the reason why God calls us in the book of Isaiah 1:18. That come that we may reason with you. That even if your sin is as red as a scarlet, I shall make them as white as the snow. Praise God.
Amen.
So if there is a point where we need a lot of reasoning, is all about the condition of our young people in their involvement in all activities in the society. That is the reason why I really encourage this church, that we may have such a program, many of them. Because even in the Bible history, all those servants that were used by God, beginning from Moses until the end, they were the youth. They were the young people that God used. And so I'm going to pose this challenge also to the young people. That the way you are living your life, do you think you are pleasing God with what you are doing? It is high time that the young people may change their ways of life. It is high time that even the young people may want to be sanctified by God. Without which, no youth will make it to heaven. Let me not also mix my words when I'm addressing them. That God is looking at you and looking at a great soldier that will overcome the challenges of this life, that will overcome the challenges of youthful life, that will overcome and endure the temptations that are assailing them at these times of the end. Our sermon comes from the book of Matthew 22. I will talk to the young people in the afternoon. Already we are in the afternoon after lunch. Let me say that. And we are going to read from Matthew 22 verse 1 to verse 12. That is when we are going to do some few explanations here and there, and then we end it. Can I have somebody read?
And Jesus said and spoke to them again by parables, and said, the kingdom of heaven is like a certain king who arranged a marriage for his son, and sent out his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding, and they were not willing to come. Again, he sent out other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and fatted cattle are killed and all things are ready. Come to the wedding. But they made light of it and went their ways, one to his own farm, another to his business. And the rest seized his servants, treated them spitefully, and killed them. But when the king heard about it, he was furious, and he sent out his armies, destroyed those murderers, and burned up their city. Then he said to his servants, "The wedding is ready, but those who are invited were not worthy. Therefore, go into the highways, and as many as you find, invite to the wedding." So those servants went out into the highways and gathered together all whom they found, both bad and good. And the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to see the guests, he saw a man there who did not have on a wedding garment. So he said to him, "Friend, how did you come in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
We are seeing Jesus' way of describing the kingdom that is to come. And he gave a parable, and in that parable we saw the king organizing a wedding for the son. And that the culmination of that wedding was an officiating of the marriage. And there were also guests that were invited. And then somebody was found in the right place but with the wrong garment. And then one thing that we need to notice also from that parable is that this person was formerly a friend of the king. And when he was asked a question, he was speechless. Now let us break it down, the parable. Jesus severally used a parable in his teachings. And a parable are just the words that are used as symbols to bring home a given point. And it was the time when many Sadducees and Pharisees were following Jesus. And their main aim of following Jesus was never to get saved. But their main reason was only to find any fault of how they could hang him. And then Jesus gave that parable. The king there is God the Father. And the son there is Jesus Christ. And the marriage union is found in the book of Matthew 19 verse 6. Tunaangalia katika hali hiyo wapendwa, ya kwamba kuna arusi na ndani ya arusi kuna ndoa. Na tunaangalia kwamba ni hafla ambayo iliweza kutengenezwa na Mungu mwenyewe kwa ajili ya wateule wake. Akimpooza mke kwa mtoto wake ambaye ndiye Yesu Kristo. Na katika njia hiyo tunaelewa kwamba kuna wale walioalikwa katika ndoa. Kuna waalikwa wa kwanza na kuna waalikwa wa pili. Na pia kuna waalikwa wa tatu. Cha muhimu ni kwamba walipokuwa wakialikwa hawakuambiwa vazi rasmi ambayo wanahitaji kuweza kuvaa. Haijaonekana mahali popote katika mafungu haya. Lakini kwa sababu walikwisha jua elimu, walikwisha pata elimu ya vile ambavyo walihitajika kuweza kuvaa wanapoenda katika ndoa, ili wapasa kila mmoja kutumia akili yake na kuweza kuvaa kulingana na hafla hiyo. Leo hii wapendwa, unapoalikwa katika harusi, hakuna mtu atakuja kukuambia vaa nguo aina fulani. Na cha kushangaza ni kwamba wengi watakao kuja kuhudhuria harusi, wengi wao watakuwa wamevaa nguo zinazopendeza. Katika eneo la kina mama utaona wamevaa manguo ambazo katika njuga zao wameinuka, na nguo zao wanatembea katika hatua za madaha. wakijaribu kupendeza zaidi. Lakini jambo moja ambayo mara nyingi tunazingatia katika harusi ni kwamba waalikwa wasiwe warembo na wasiwe wanao wale ambao wanametameta zaidi ya bibi harusi. Hicho ni kiwango ambacho wale ambao wamekuwa katika hali ya kuunganisha ndoa, hicho wanakijua. The maids are not supposed to be more beautiful and more smarter than the bride. But now this is very strange. This wedding that we are talking about is where all the garments are to look similar, even the one that even the bride adorns. There is something that happened. The book of Matthew 19 verse 6. What is the meaning of marriage?
So then, they are no longer two, but one flesh. Therefore, what God hath joined together, let no man separate.
Praise God.
Amen.
It is only in the context of the wedding that two becomes one. And if I was diving into the romance in the book of Genesis, nilipokuwa nikitazama, when God commanded Adam in the Garden of Eden that you can now kiss the bride, that you can now embrace the bride, and you can now tell this woman good words, do you think God had caused Adam of the words that he needed to say? Do you think God had called him aside and told him that this is the woman, this is how you are going to interact with her? The occasion itself projected those words from Adam. And then Adam said, this is now the bone of my bones. This is now the flesh of my flesh. And she will be called a woman because she was taken out of who?
My ribs.
And many a times, many of us in this church have known that there is no romance in the Bible. Let me tell you, even if you are a prophecy speaker, I want you to know that the story of the Bible is the story of a man and a woman. The story of a man, Jesus, who is coming for the bride, who is we, who are prepared and adorned for the husband. Because if you go to the book of Isaiah 54 verse 5, the Bible says that thy creator is thy husband. Holy of Israel is his name. Praise God.
Amen.
So in the history of the Bible, there is romance in the context of the marriage. And that is exactly the picture that we are seeing here. And it is exactly there that we are seeing two women assailing this one man. If you go to the book of Isaiah 4 verse 1, the Bible says that at the time of the end, seven women shall come to this one wife, try to cling unto him, that let us only be called by your name. We are going to have our own clothes. We are going to have our own food. But allow us to be just called by your name. Praise God.
Amen.
How many are the husbands here? Does your wife use your name? Yes or no?
Yes.
Those who are married.
Yes.
Do women take names?
Yes.
Where did you get that? It is because the Bible said that a woman needs to have the name of a husband. And so we as a church, as the bride of Christ, the number one thing that we need to take from Christ is his name.
Amen.
Praise God.
Amen.
Because that name comes with a character.
Hallelujah.
That name comes with an expectation. That name dictates even how we behave. That name of our husband, Jesus Christ, even helps us how to live happily in our marriages.
Hallelujah.
That name dictates even how we walk. That name dictates even how we dress.
Amen.
That name dictates even the words that come out of our mouths.
Amen.
And because of that, I even remember the example of Sarah calling Abraham his Lord. Then it means that even at the time when a woman is approaching the husband, there's some level of submission that is supposed to be there. The book of Ephesians 5, verse 25, verse 22 says that women be submitted to your husbands, just as the church is expected to be submissive to Jesus Christ. So let us go back to the wedding. That the bride, let me surprise you, that the bride is never Seventh-day Adventist church. I know there are many questions. Can you read the book of Galatians chapter 2 verse 26? The bride is not only a Seventh-day Adventist church, because we are seeing here that the bride, they are also the remnants of our seed. We are seeing a seed of a woman, and we are also seeing a woman. And now when we are talking about the woman in this case, we are not talking about Seventh-day Adventist church. We are talking about a bigger entity, an entity that is going to accommodate every class of people in the world. Some of them are not Seventh-day Adventists today. We are just the remnant of the woman. And the question is, if Jesus really is the husband in this case, who is the wife? Revelation 12 talks about a clean woman, a virtuous woman. But now when we come to understand this, that the devil only assails the woman with her seed, then who is the seed? The seed is Seventh-day Adventist church members, praise God,
amen.
Who are the remnants within the church. But church, as a woman in the prophecy, is a bigger entity that Jesus will be married to. Revelation 21 says that I saw the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven, adorned as the bride. To who? To the husband. So then it means that we have a rough idea of who the Jerusalem, who the woman is. Can you read Galatians 4 verse 26?
4:26 Galatians
says,
but the Jerusalem above is free.
The Jerusalem above is free,
which is the mother of us all.
Praise God.
Amen.
So that is the church. But we Adventists are the remnants of her seed. Amen. So we are almost waiting to culminate the culmination of the wedding, the officiating of the marriage between Christ and the New Jerusalem. It is a wedding that is going to take place in heaven, and all of us have been guests as the remnant of our seed, and we are invited that we may attend the wedding, and then we proceed to the reception of the wedding. Amen. That is where we will be officially. And if you go also to the book of Matthew 25, you are going to see that there are two classes of people that are going to be found in the invitation of the wedding. There are those who were invited, but for some reasons they were not ready for the wedding. And they are also on this other side, those who are ready for the wedding. But that is not the message of today. The message is the marriage of the Lamb. And now in this parable, brethren, we are seeing that they are the first call. There is that first call, that they were the first people that were called officially. They were invited with letters. Normally, people are invited in weddings with letters and cards. The first class of people, the guests that were honored, highly honored, that were called to that wedding, are the people that are called the Jewish people. Let us read the book of John chapter 4 verse 22. We are almost witnessing the union of divinity and humanity. We are almost seeing God coming down to come together with them that have been walking righteously on this earth. And that is exactly the wedding that we are seeing there. That Jesus is using a parable to tell us that we need to be ready for this wedding. Let me just ask you, anytime that we are almost getting to a wedding, are there preparations? Are there preparations? Yes. And so all of us also need to prepare for this wedding, because we are all the invited guests. But in the parable of Jesus, in verse 3, that they are the first call, that there was a first call that was made. Kuna wale ambao walialikwa mara ya kwanza na wote wakakataa kuja. Soma. Walialikwa mara ya kwanza ni akina nani? Na kwa nini wao ndio walitokea duniani ni kama wao ndio waalikwa wa kwanza? Kitabu ambacho ni cha Yohana 4:22 Biblia inasema,
"But the hour is coming."
Muda inakuja na saa yaja.
"And now is."
Ambao imeshawadia.
"When the true worshippers."
Ambao waabuduo wa kweli.
"Will worship the Father."
Watamwabudu Bwana.
"In spirit and truth."
Katika roho na kweli. Enda verse 22.
"You worship that you do not know."
Munaabudu ambacho hamkijui.
"We know what we worship."
Nasi tunayajua yule ambaye tunamwabudu.
"For salvation is of the Jews."
Kwa maana wokovu ni wa nani?
Wayahudi. Jews.
Wayahudi.
Thank you.
Na Wayahudi walivyoalikwa katika mwaliko huu wa kujiandaa kwa ajili ya harusi hii, wengi wakakataa mwito. Na ni kwa nini Wayahudi ndio waliitwa kwanza? Ukisoma kitabu cha Matendo 3:1, tutasoma kwa haraka. Matendo 3:1. The Bible says in English, "What advantage then has the Jew, or what profit is there of circumcision? Much every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God, that to, unto the Jewish people as a nation were committed what? The oracles of God." And then I went to Webster's dictionary, utafuta what the oracles of God is. Because the question is, why did the Jewish people have advantage in the gospel dispensation? And that is what I'm explaining. That unto them, according to Acts 3:1, that unto them were committed the oracles of God. And now we need to break down what are the oracles of God. And this is what the Webster dictionary said about that. That among Christians, oracles is the plural. In the plural, denotes the communications, revelations, or messages delivered by God to prophets. If you look at the Bible, you find that most of the prophets were the Jewish people. To them were committed, and they were charged with the responsibility of preaching Christ unto the people. To an extent that when God was supposed to be looking at them as an example and as a spectacle for them that are living on the earth. Wakati Mungu alichukua wokovu akawapatia Wayahudi, aliwapatia ili kwamba wanapoonekana wakitembea, wanapoonekana wakiishi, waweze kuishi katika njia ambayo inaleta picha kamili ya sura ya Mwenyezi Mungu duniani. Lakini because waliitwa mara ya kwanza, wakapewa opportunity ya kwanza, wakajiona kwamba wameingia na kiburi, wakajiona kwamba wao ni wazuri zaidi. And by the way, that is the reason why there is a great battle in Middle East. Because many people want to be identified by the Jerusalem. Because it was a good nation. It was a holy nation. A special place in the eyes of God. Praise God.
Amen.
But because wakaalikwa wa kwanza, wote wakakataa. Wayahudi wakapewa muda ya miaka 490. The 70 weeks of the book of Daniel was set aside for them, that they may do God's work, that they may be an example of the society. But at the end of the day, what did they do? Baada ya kualikwa katika harusi, Wayahudi wakamkataa Mwenyezi Mungu, wakamkataa Kristo. Now listen to the spiritual prophecy in the book of Christ Object Lesson, page 307, paragraph 2. It says, "In this parable, as in that of Great Supper, are illustrated the gospel invitation." Katika fumbo ambao Kristo alitumia, inaonyesha kwamba ni hali ya kualikwa katika kazi ya Mwenyezi Mungu. It's rejection by the Jewish people. I'm repeating that again. In this parable, as in that of the Great Supper, are illustrated the gospel invitation, its rejection by the Jewish people, and the call of mercy to the Gentiles. But on the part of those who reject the invitation, this parable brings to view a deeper insult and a more dreadful punishment. The call to the feast is a king's invitation. It proceeds from one who is vested with power to command. It confers high honor, yet the honor is unappreciated. The king's authority is despised. Na tulivorudi kuangalia vizuri, tunaona katika miongoni mwa Wayahudi walipatikana Masadukayo na Mafarisayo, watu wawili ambao waliongoza Waisraeli katika hali ya kumkataa Kristo alivyokuja hapa duniani. Na hivyo ndivyo ni mfano ambao Kristo aliitumia, na wakageukia maneno yao na matendo ya sheria zaidi ya kumgeukia Kristo. Na hivyo ndivyo tunaona Mungu akaalika wanafunzi wao miongoni mwao 12, akawaleta ili kwamba waweze kuhubiri injili. Lakini katika hali hiyo wakamkataa Kristo na wakakataa invitation of the king. Baadaye Kristo akatuma 70 kuweza kuenda kupeleka injili, lakini vile vile wao nao wakakataliwa na Wayahudi wenyewe. And then at the expiry of the 70 day, the 70 weeks prophecy of the book of Daniel, Daniel 8 verse 14, we are seeing that now the door of mercy was opened for them for a little while, even after killing Christ. We see that they were given another chance again, that they may seek God again and repent. But what did they do? In 34 AD, they killed the servant Stephen. And that, by doing that, they sealed their fate with the blood of the saint. From that time, the door of mercy was closed temporarily for them. And then God opened the gospel dispensation for the other people. That is the history and the heritage of our church. And tukirudi katika kitabu cha Mathayo 22, tunaona kwamba walialikwa wa kwanza walikuwa ni Wayahudi, wakakataa Kristo, wakaingia kugeukia njia zao na wakatengeneza hali zao za haki ambao waliigeukia, wakatae Bwana wa haki, Bwana Yesu Kristo. Baada ya kumuua Yesu, wakapewa muda wa miaka chache, ili miaka 3.5, ili waweze kumgeukia Mwenyezi Mungu. Lakini hakuna mtu alimgeukia Mwenyezi Mungu. Mathayo 22 aya 4 inasema, again he sent forth other servants saying, tell them which are Biden, behold, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen, my fatlings are killed, and all things are ready, come unto the marriage. Wapendwa, kwa sababu hii ni fumbo ambao Mungu anatumia, inatubidi tuweze kuingia ndani ya maandiko ili kwamba tuweze kuelewa ujumbe ambao wale waalikwa wa kwanza walipewa, waliambiwa kujeni katika ndoa. Lakini ujumbe wa pili, kuna maneno fulani yameongezwa. Mungu ameongeza maneno pale akisema kwamba enda uambie kwamba nimekwisha chinja nini? Nimechinja ng'ombe aliyenona. Na katika hali hiyo, hebu tazama jinsi mambo yalivyokuwekwa tayari. Na hapo ndio tunaona ndio wakati ambao ujumbe ilifunguliwa kwa watu wasio Wayahudi, ambao ni watu wa dunia. Na champion of the gospel Paulo akainuliwa kuweza kupropagate the gospel na kupeleka injili hiyo miongoni mwa watu waliodharauliwa, miongoni mwa watu ambao walidharauliwa na Wayahudi, kwa watu wa Samaria, watu wa Jerusalem, watu ambao wanatoka nje, waliokataliwa na Wayahudi hata katika hali yao ya ibada, wote wakaalikwa katika koli ya pili, wakaitwa ili kwamba waweze kuja katika ndoa. Lakini jambo moja ambao tunahitaji kuweza kuelewa, ukienda katika Mambo ya Walawi, kitabu cha Mambo ya Walawi 4 aya ya 8, let us go to the book of Leviticus 4 verse 8 to understand the bull, that the oxen that has been slaughtered, and the fatlings that were seen in the picture. Hiyo ilikuwa inamaanisha nini? Kwa kusema kwamba nimekwisha chinja kondoo nimechinja ng'ombe aliyenona, hiyo event inaitwaje? Na itatusaidia kuweza kuelewa. Soma msomaji.
He shall take from it all the fat of the bull.
Yes.
As the sin offering.
Yes.
The fat that covers the entrails.
Yes.
And all the fat which is on the entrails.
Kwa hivyo tunapoangalia hali hiyo ya kuchinja, ni ile hali ya kafara ya nini? Ya dhambi. Na tunapoangalia kwamba kafara ya pekee ya dhambi ambayo inazungumziwa katika historia ya ulimwengu mzima ni kafara ya pekee ya Yesu Kristo kufa msalabani. Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Katika hali hiyo Mungu bado anaendelea kusumbuka kuwapokea watu wake na kuweza kuwafikia katika njia hiyo ya injili. Na ndio tunaona watu wasio wazaliwa Wayahudi kwa hali ya kuzaliwa wanaalikwa sasa katika hali ya kuhusika katika kazi ya Mwenyezi Mungu. Na ndio tunaona Mungu anamwaga mvua. Mungu anakuja kuwapatia Roho Mtakatifu ili kwamba wanafunzi wa Mwenyezi Mungu, all the apostles, waweze kuenda katika uso wa nchi yote wakieneza injili ya habari njema ya Kristo kurudi kwake. And friends, that was the second call. But even at that, they rejected them and they treated them spitefully. Can you go to 22 verse 5? Msomaji, naomba unisomee 22 aya 5 na aya 6 ambayo ni kitabu hicho hicho cha Mathayo 22.
Aya 5 na ya 6.
Naona wengine wanalala katika congregation. If your neighbor is sleeping, wake him up. Mwambie, we are almost getting to the wedding. Wake up. Soma.
Lakini hawakujali.
Hawakujali.
Wakaenda zao. Mmoja shambani kwake.
Kila mmoja shambani kwake.
Mmoja kwenye biashara yake.
Wengine wakaenda katika biashara zao.
Na waliosalia.
Wakawakamata
watumwa wake.
Yes.
Wakawatenga jeuri.
Uh-huh.
Na kuwaua.
Sikia. Hii ndio wakati ambapo wana wa Mungu na watu wa Mungu walitumwa kuja kuhubiri injili. Na ndio persecution ikakuwa juu sana. Na wanafunzi wa Yesu wakauawa katika njia ya ajabu. Tunaona wengine kama akina Yakobo wakapelekwa katika mnara ule mkubwa wa hekalu la Yerusalemu, wakasukumwa ili waanguke chini. Na wote akanusurika katika hali hiyo. Na wakamfuata tena huko chini, wakachukua rungu wakaanza kumtandika nayo. Hivyo ndivyo waliwapiga na kuwaua wanafunzi wa Yesu, kasoro mmoja ambaye ni Yohana wa Patmo. Peke yake ndio Mungu alimnusuru, akiwa na mpangilio naye kwamba atakuja kumtumia katika nyakati za mwisho. Kwa hivyo tunaona hata wale walioalikwa katika harusi mara ya pili, wote nao wakakataa. Na Mungu akafanya jambo, teremka na andiko.
Basi yule mfalme
ambaye ni Mungu Mwenyezi
akagadhabika
sana,
akapeleka majeshi yake akawaangamiza wauaji wale akauteketeza mji wao.
Hiyo ndio unabii ambayo iliweza kutimia mwaka wa 70 baada ya kuja kwa Yesu, ambao wafalme wa ufalme wa Roma ikaingia katika Yerusalemu, ikaingia pale na ikaribu kanisa na hekalu pamoja na watu, mpaka watu wakauawa kiasi kubwa, na watu walikufa mpaka hakuna mtu alikuwa na uwezo wa kuweza kuwazika. Damu ikamwagika ndani ya hekalu. Hivyo ndivyo ilivyokuwa, wapendwa. Unapoangalia katika historia ya injili vile ilivyoanza, wapendwa, ilianza na watu ambao waliwekwa kama watu wa pekee, ikakuja kwa watu ambao pia wamerithi upekee na wainjili wakiendelea kuishi maisha yao. Lakini hata katika hali hiyo wengine wakajishughulisha na ahadi zao. Na ukienda katika kitabu cha Luka 14, 16 mpaka 20, utaona pia kwamba katika mwaliko huo huo kuna wengine walitoa udhuru. Wengine wakasema kwamba nimenunua ng'ombe wangu, hebu ngoja kwanza niende niwajaribu. Mwingine akasema nimeoa mke juzi, hebu enda nipatie nafasi niende nikae na wao na yeye. Mwingine naye akasema kwamba nilienda nikanunua shamba juzi, bado nahitaji kujenga. Na katika hali hiyo wakamkataa Bwana wa Sabato, mfalme wa amani, Kristo aliyetoa mwili wa mwanadamu akakuja kufa kifo cha aibu kwa ajili yetu. Wapendwa, leo hii, is there anything that you have valued so much above that which is of God? Je, umetoa udhuru katika kazi ya Mwenyezi Mungu? Ni mara ngapi wa Kristo wa leo hii waalikwa wa pili ambao wanastahili kuweza kupeleka injili ya Kristo katika pembe zote za dunia, wanaambia wainuke waende kufanya kazi ya Mungu na wao wanatoa udhuru. Mwingine anasema bado nahitaji kufanya mikakati ninunue ploti nijenge. Wengine wanasema mimi ni kijana bado nilioa juzi, nahitaji kukaa na mke wangu. Wengine wanasema nilianzisha biashara yangu juzi, nikienda kwa mission ya one week biashara yangu itaanguka. Wengine wanasema kwamba unajua mimi ni mfanyikazi wa serikali, hakuna vile nitakavyoenda, nitavutwa katika kazi yangu. Katika eneo hili, hasa katika wakati ambao tunaishi, watu wanaotoa maudhuru mengi kwa sababu wanaona kwamba kazi ya Mungu haiwezi enda. Wengine wanasema kwamba hata kanisa siwezi enda kwa sababu je, uliona TV, cases of COVID zimekuwa ngapi? Na katika hali hiyo, makanisa zinabaki chache. Watu ambao wanakuja kanisani wanakuwa ni wachache. At the end of the day, tunakataa mwito na mwaliko ambao Kristo anatupatia katika mwaliko wa pili. Tuende katika mwaliko wa tatu. This is a story of the kingdom of God and how the gospel was dispensed to God's people. They were given a time to be involved in the gospel work. But wengi wao hawakuwa tayari. Wengine wakaonyesha the highest level of arrogance. Wakawaua na wakawatesa wale watumwa. Ni mara ngapi watumishi wanatumwa kwetu kama kanisa, and we treat them spitefully? Watu wa kanisa, Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
Unaambiwa kwamba utoe pesa ya evangelism ambayo itakuja kufanya kazi ya Mwenyezi Mungu. Alafu unasema I should do. Hata ufikirii unatoa 100. You are similar to those who treated God's people spitefully when they came to awake you up for the evangelism work. Kanisa hili liliwekwa katika misingi ya kuenda kuhubiri injili. Lakini wengi wetu, we are comfortable in our churches. At the comfort of our houses we are seated. We don't care what is going on. The souls of the young people are languishing now outside there, out in the streets. No one is going there to preach to them. No one is nurturing them. No one even wants to be identified with the young people, because in their mind they think that they are evil people. Ukienda hapo barabarani ukutane na mtu ambaye amelewa, ukikutana na Mwadventista wa Sabato akikutana na yeye, lazima mapua yake iangalie the opposite direction. Because we are seeing them that they are so evil and wicked. But maybe wewe ni mlevi hata kumshinda. You can treat them like that, and maybe you are drunkard more than them. Let me break that down. By the way, do you know that mtu ambaye anakunywa maziwa ya mala is equally drunk? It's only that he's not staggering. Even the arrangement of our food. Unatoka hapo barabarani umekunywa chai kwa nyumba, na unaenda pale kwa kibando unakata machungwa unakula. Do you know what is going on in your stomach? Fermentation. You are also drunk. It's only that the degree of drunkenness is different. You are not staggering, but they are staggering. If you disregard the health message that is given to this church, it is so easy for you to be drunk, even by the way you are eating. Some of us are also drunk with social network. To an extent that hata saa zingine tunakuja kanisani na kijana amekaa nyuma na browse. You are also drunk. So before you remove the speck on their eyes, look at the log that is on your eye. If I come to your houses on Friday, I will see that business is as usual. It doesn't even look like Seventh-day Adventist church member. You only play music on the Sabbath afternoon. But on Friday, kanungo, kanungo, kanungo. You know all the secular music. You as a young person, you know all the teams and the players. You know even the new signings. Yeah, Manchester United. That is also another drunkenness. Let's go to the book of Luke 21, verse 34. Before we saw judge, when God wanted to involve the people in the gospel, kulingana na mwaliko huu wapendwa, sio mwaliko wa kwenda kwa hukumu watu katika street ama katika ulimwengu. Ni mwaliko wa kuambia watu kwamba ingawa wewe umedhoofika na dhambi, ingawa wewe umedhoofika na pombe, walevi wanastahili, wanataka kuweza kujua vile Mungu anavyowaweka katika ufalme wake. It is high time that we change our gospel. We go there and tell them that you know God loves you and he would want so much to bring you to his fold. But some of us will behave as if ni sisi ndio tunaenda kuwaleta. Go as a vessel, leave the rest to God.
Amen.
Go and sit with the drunkards where they are. Speak to them. Give them hope. Some of these people are so, some of these people that you are seeing on the street, they are so disappointed in life. And for some reasons, they can be even justified with the kind of life that they have. You need to understand them and give them the gospel, the good news of the gospel. And invite them that the king needs you in this, in his fold. Hebu soma kitabu hicho. Luka 21:34. Tunapoishi nyakati za mwisho wapendwa, hata ingawa tuko na mission ya kuweza kwenda kuhubiri injili, there is one caution that we are given there. 21:34 says,
basi jiangalieni
sana nyinyi Waadventista wa Sabato, nyinyi waumini,
mioyo yenu isije ikalemewa na ulafi.
Na ulafi number 1,
na ulevi na masumbufu ya maisha haya.
Then
siku ile ikawajia ghafla kama mtego.
Even those who are inside the church, they also drunk with looking for money. You even sell your soul in the cheap market of work. Unafanya kazi mpaka usiku sabato. Unaanza kusema nisipofanya hii kazi nitakula nini? Kwani watu ambao hawajaajiriwa hawakuli? Swali ambalo unafaa kujiuliza. Asilimia karibu 70 ya Wakenya hawajaajiriwa, informal employment. Are they feeding? So God cares.
Amen.
Give God his time. He has given you a whole of six what? 6 days. And you still rob him of a half of his day. One day only. Do you think that God is selfish?
No.
Naona mpaka saa zingine mshiriki wa kanisa anakuja, anapiga simu. Enda. Alafu wakupatie mahindi gunia mbili. Na you are right in the compound of the church. Ubebe tu. Wacha akupatie. Amekuja kanisani lakini ameacha mtumwa wake, anaendelea na nini? Na kazi biashara inaendelea. Mwingine anasema, leo ni game gani inacheza? Arsenal na Man U. Umeweka kichwa ama umeweka mikia? Inakuwa kichwa ama mkemkia ama inawekwa nini? You are ready betting. You are betting as you are on your way to church. And then ukikutana na mlevi kwa barabara unamfanya. That is your partner in crime. So partners in crime treat each other better. Praise God.
Amen.
I don't want us to preach the gospel as if we have gone to heaven and we are back, and we have known already what is in heaven, and we have already known who is going to be there and who is not going to be there. That is spiteful treating of the messengers. Mara ngapi mmebagua hata watumishi hapo? Wacha niseme tu. Kama ni pastor ametoka conference, hata facilitation yake inakuwa tofauti na evangelist kutoka Kabarnet. Ikifika wakati wa kula unasema, because he's a pastor we can take him to an hotel aende aishi huko. Unajua huyo ni president of the conference. Ingawa tunaenda katika mahubiri ya injili, lakini we have classes inside the church. There are those of high class, na kuna wale wa wapi? Wa chini. Kuna wale wa kutembelewa haraka wakipata shida, na kuna wale wa kukuja kuingia kwa board kudiscuss mambo yao kwanza. Do you think we are effective in the gospel dispensation? We are spitefully treating God's servants, and we are mistreating Christ in the process. It is my prayer that you may take heed, amen, that you may not be found that on that day you don't have a wedding garment. Verse 7, 22.
But when the king heard about it, he was furious. And he sent out his armies.
Yes.
Destroyed those murderers.
Yes.
And burned up their city.
That was fulfilled in 70 AD.
Then he said to his servants.
He's now calling. He's making people the last call, one final call,
yes,
to the wedding. Listen to this now. Sikiza vizuri. The last call, hajachoka, amealika wa kwanza, wamekataa. Amealika wa pili, wamekataa, na wakaua wale watumishi, na wakawatunza vibaya, wakawa mistreat, they segregated them, wakadiscriminate watumishi wa Mwenyezi Mungu. Sikia, anaalika mwaliko wa tatu.
The wedding is ready.
Anasema ndoa ii tayari.
But those who are invited,
lakini wale ambao wamealikwa hawako tayari. Hawastahili. Kwa sababu gani? Sikia maneno haya. Ya kwanza amesema kujeni kuna ndoa. Ya pili akasema nimekwisha chinja. Ya tatu anakuja kualika watu ambao sasa ameacha ile kundi ya kwanza. Anaenda katika new people, new ground. Anaenda sasa kuwatafuta wale waliopotea, kama vile Kristo alivyosema katika kitabu cha Luka kwamba ana mchungaji mzuri uwacha wale kondoo 99 na kuenda kutafuta yule mmoja, na akikuja kumleta, akimleta katika zizi lake, mbingu mzima inanyamaza, inaingia katika sherehe ikimsherekea mtu huyu mmoja ambaye amepeana maisha yake katika Kristo. You can see how important this one sheep is. That is the last call that we are making today. That there is maybe there's a sheep somewhere that needs to hear these words. That God loves them. That all of us are going to be in the same heaven. Even if you are going to preach about the beast, we preach it with love. Praise God.
Amen.
I'm not saying don't preach it, because Jesus said, go and preach it. In the book of Matthew 24, verse 15. Jesus said, investigate the book of Daniel. Tell the people the events of the end. But preach it with love. Praise God.
Amen.
Show the people that apart from these kingdoms, there is also the kingdom of Christ. The kingdom of the stone that will come. And many people who are ready for this kingdom will be with Jesus for 1,000 years in heaven. Hallelujah. And that, in other words, will be the honeymoon after the marriage. Amen. Praise God. I wonder who will be there in that honeymoon. The last call. I'm almost finishing.
Basi enendeni hata njia panda za barabara.
Enendeni anywhere katika njia panda za barabara.
Na wote mnaoona.
Na mtu yeyote ambaye umeona.
Waiteni harusini.
Waiteni harusini.
Watumwa wale wakatoka wakaenda njia
kuachia hapo. This is the last message ambayo tunastahili kupeleka, na jinsi tunavyostahili kuweza kuzipeleka. Yule mlevi ambayo mara nyingi unamgeuzia nyuso katika upande mwingine, yeye ndio unastahili kuweza kumwalika. Yule kahaba ambaye ako katika street, yule ndiye anastahili kufanywa nini? Kualikwa. There is no formula.
Amen.
The direction is only one. Bring all of them.
Amen.
Anybody.
Amen.
Without looking at the class. Without looking at the social status, and awalete katika zizi la Mwenyezi Mungu. Wote wanahitajika kuweza kuingia katika ndoa ya pekee, kwa maana wale walialikwa wa kwanza walikataa.
ingawa walikuwa watu spesheli, wale wa pili pia wakakataa na wakaua mpaka watumishi wale. Hii mwaliko wa mwisho haina ubaguzi wapendwa, haina mpaka wa ukabila, haina mpaka wa rangi, haina mpaka wa mali, haina mpaka wa awe mtumwa, awe mtu aliye huru. Sote tunahitajika kuweza kuenda.
Amen.
Na hapa ndio tunahitaji nguvu ya vijana kuweza kuhusika katika kazi hii.
Hallelujah.
Na wataendaje kama hawana ujumbe? Paulo anauliza, ataendaje kama hajatumwa? Umetumwa tayari.
Hallelujah.
Utaendaje bila ujumbe? Ujumbe umepewa ambao ni Ufunuo 14:6. Ambayo inasema mcheni Mungu na kumtukuza, kwa maana saa ya hukumu yake imekuja. Msujudieni yeye aliyezifanya mbingu na nchi na chemichemi za maji.
Atawakusanya, yu ajaye.